All right. Hi, David.
Hello.
How are you today?
I'm here at the alien crash site, so I have to be a bit careful.
Oh, that's why you're glowing.
It's why I'm glowing, because I'm glowing in the reflection of the combustion of the hyperwarp drives.
Of course. So I should take a moment to introduce you, introduce the project. This is a new interplanetary interview series called Alien Crash Site. It is hosted by me. I am Caitlin McShea. And it was invented by you, David Krakauer. David Krakauer is the William H. Miller Professor of Complex Systems at the Santa Fe Institute. He is also the president of the Santa Fe Institute and the inaugurator captain of the Interplanetary Project. And the Alien Crash Site interview series will explore, apparently, a variety of artifacts, many of which David has in his possession currently.
Yeah.
Oh, see, that's just a good one.
I'm just going through a few to sort of give people a sense of what we might be talking about.
Right.
Quite promising.
I'm glad. I've played with that one. That's a tricky one, but I've seen you solve it.
Yeah.
So, this one, David.
David brought that from another planet.
Alien Crash Site.
Okay, yes. Sorry about that.
That's okay. I can say, let me also say that Alien Crash Site existed kind of in the realm of the invention of Interplanetary. So, like, we started talking about Alien Crash Site back in 2017 before Interplanetary ever launched. We just have the opportunity to kind of get into it now that 2020 has made us all isolated in our own zones.
Yeah.
So, if you want to talk a little bit.
We live in an alien crash site. Yeah, so the idea of Alien Crash Site is sort of the following, which is, imagine that you stumble onto an alien crash site and you discover an artifact of extraterrestrial provenance. And the key is that this discovery could change everything. This, by analyzing this, by studying this, whatever that object was, you might come to an understanding that you wouldn't have had otherwise. And so that's the idea. And what are these artifacts? And that's, I guess, the series is an effort or an attempt to ask people what their ultimate alien crash site artifact would be, how it would work, how it would change everything, and discuss, you know, this, what does that mean in the broader context of our stage of technological evolution, right? And it could be anything. It could be a pencil, could be a piece of chalk, could be something very enigmatic, like this, for example. And that's the basic idea. And so, yeah.
And so, but that idea, I think, stems from this 70s Soviet sci-fi novel, The Roadside Picnic by the Strugatsky brothers. And I think that's important to mention because there's a great fear risk. It's not like you just stumble upon this lovely meadow and you find things that change the planet. Like, you could die. You could dissolve.
Yes, exactly. No, that's right. So, yes, Stalker, which, of course, is the film by Tarkovsky based on the Strugatsky brothers' Roadside Picnic. So we'll talk about that a little bit. And then we'll put it in a larger context because I think it's kind of fun to do that. Yeah, so the idea of Roadside Picnic is that there has been some event, some visitation, and a crash perhaps, or a visit. And a series of zones on the planet, six of them, have somehow been infected by some presence or some technology. And the governments of the world have decreed that this should be non-visitable, that it should be avoided. And they're right, because it's full of dangers and traps, but it's also full of objects which seem to be miraculous, or purported to be miraculous. And there are figures who enter into these areas, these zones, illegally in search of artifacts, which they can then sell. Mm-hmm. And they have all sorts of horrible names, and they can turn you into slime and God knows what. And the most sought after of all artifacts is this golden sphere. And the golden sphere is an artifact that it is believed gives you some access to some universal knowledge. And what you slowly dawns on you over the course of time is it's not clear precisely what this is, right? In other words, why does this place exist? What happened? What is this technology? How do you understand it? And there's a kind of a twist without giving anything away. And the Strugatsky brothers suggest that actually what we consider these super advanced technologies were actually just litter or the detritus of a picnic, right? That aliens took where they sort of stopped off on Earth. Not necessarily, I think they did it by mistake. They had to go to the toilet or something.
Precisely.
Right? They had a bit of a picnic and they left all this stuff behind, which to us, of course, seems miraculous. So it's a bit of a twist that what one civilization might consider earth-shatteringly, planet-shatteringly advanced, to another civilization is just its garbage. And that was always a very interesting idea. But this, Stalker, was Russian filmmaker Tarkovsky's take on the Strugatsky brothers, but that's the same sort of idea that the Polish science fiction writer Stanisław Lem wrote this wonderful book, Solaris, about a sentient planet. Tarkovsky makes a movie about it and humanizes it. So Tarkovsky humanized Roadside Picnic and turned it into something much more mystical with a completely different cast of characters. Mm-hmm. Now you have the stalker, you have the writer, and you have the professor, and it's not quite clear to me why. We could discuss that, but and now the zone is in some sense almost like a grail legend where they're going in search of the meaning of life and some form of salvation for themselves or their family,
right?
And the room is the golden sphere.
Yeah, I would say it's a loose adaptation of 2 minutes of the book, but it's like an amplification of the mood of the mystery of the zone, like, and the time, like the idea is that when stalkers exist in the zone, they have no idea how long they're in there. They find out it's days. I think that Tarkovsky does a good job of eliciting that feeling, but it's not a true adaptation. Audience should know, but it's great.
it absolutely, it's very Tarkovsky style. Tarkovsky wasn't really interested in science at all. He was interested in the spirit. And so he took, very interestingly, took that idea of this area of mystery and pursued a kind of a quest narrative. But
it's good to bring that up because now it kind of draws into focus the very diverse quality of what an object or artifact could be. So in Stalker, it's a room, it's a location. In the book, it's a golden sphere or a sparkler or whatever. And now, you know, we can go on to envision what is this artifact? How do we interpret what we discover?
Yeah, so right. And so, right, we've talked about this, about the series here and how we might think about these artifacts. And I think, I think of everything in terms of threes and 3x3 tables and three. And of course, you want to think about the artifact from the perspective of the producer of the artifact, the constructor, the extraterrestrial. Why did they do it? Did they do it for us, like in 2001, where they leave us a monolith to sort of accelerate our cultural evolution? So that was very deliberate somehow. Did they do what the Strugatsky brothers did, which is just, it was their litter. They had no intention of leaving us anything.
They didn't even notice us.
We didn't notice us and didn't care. So there's that kind of thing. There's a more sinister kind of object, like in War of the Worlds, where they were left underground forever before we'd even evolved just to destroy us once we did, which is a bit like the Andromeda strain, by the way, through the lens of Andromeda Evolution, the sequel, which we just finished. And then there's the sort of thing that's left behind that's super sophisticated and designed for purposes which have nothing to do with us, but we intercept, right? And so that's in Stanisław Lem's other great book, His Master's Voice, there's a neutrino signal which we intercept. We never decipher it, But in the process of trying to understand it, we manufacture things. So it has this other benefit.
Right, so there's this halfway understanding that we can still gain utility from, even though we're completely ignorant to its true function.
Exactly, and that we never will know.
Right.
And then, so that's them, and then there's us, right? And they're all sort of entangled. But it seems to me it'd be kind of fun to discuss real objects in Earth history that we've discovered that have a little bit of this quality of being a crash site artifact.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, what they stand for in our culture and in literature before we get on to, you know, my artifact, which we totally transformed it.
Yeah, so there seems to be this kind of historical rallying towards mystery as miraculous. So when you think of things like the Easter Island heads, or you think of the Stonehenge, or these physical spaces, much like the room, because they can't be explained, or because we haven't yet, at the time of their discovery, been able to replicate their placement, we assume that it's something other. We assume that it's usually extraterrestrials or religious, some kind of other universal leader. And we attempt forever in archaeological practices and anthropological practices to try to get closer to understanding, but it's like the law of infinite divisibility. So we're like that, the hope to find function or meaning. And maybe we have in a kind of mythical sense, but probably not, even if they are human created or alien left, we probably don't fully understand them. And that happens across time.
Yeah, that's true. Ooh. Yeah, no, that's right. I think that those are a great sort of petroglyph, petroforms, megaliths all have that quality, partly because of their scale,
mm-hmm.
and what seems to be an extraordinary understanding of cosmology and orbits, that they encode astronomical events, lead certain deranged people to suggest that they are of alien origin, but they make for wonderful science fiction. But you're right, I mean, this idea that unlike standard science where you get to do experiments, where you don't get to do experiments with history, so the evidence is always circuitous,
mm-hmm.
and you can never be sure that you've understood. So they do have that quality, I think you're absolutely right, this mysterious quality that they seem to be there for a purpose. They were built by humans, so we should be able to divine the purpose. But nevertheless, we never do perfectly. Yeah, that's absolutely true.
But so there is, I think the encoded part is kind of fundamental to what you say. Let's assume they were built by humans. I might be a little more like extra romantic, but let's assume they were built by humans. They most likely were. They do seem to encode some meaningful knowledge leap. Like now we know when to harvest our crops. Now we know when visibility is safest for travel, things like that. And so it seems like these artifacts that we're going to be discussing, things that we're pulling out of the zones, have to do the same. That's why they're so misunderstood. They're encoded, but with a function.
Yeah, I mean,
we assume that it's for our good. We assume that the function is for our benefit. We don't know.
Well, not necessarily for ours. I mean, you know, we talked about the Rosetta Stone, right? Okay. Rosetta Stone had a function, and that function was to provide a means of interpreting three different languages, right? And so this is something like a second century BC, I guess, and it's a stone stela, and it has ancient Egyptian, Demotic, and Greek. And that was buried under the ground until Napoleon decided to go and conquer, Egypt, and in the process takes his savants with him, and they excavate this extraordinary artifact, and they know one of the languages, or maybe one and a half, and so it took a while until one person came along, Champollion, and did it, solved it, and was able to use it then as a reference for interpreting Egyptian script elsewhere. So that's a nice example of something. I think when it was found in Memphis, I think when King Ptolemy had it made, it wasn't made for posterity, I don't think. I think it was made for their own purposes, although I'm not sure. you know, and then that information was lost for, you know, nearly 2,000 years until it was then finally decoded. So that's an interesting example of an artifact that's turned out to be extraordinarily important. But its function, I'm not sure. It's interesting. I don't know who it was for. Mm-hmm. But there are plenty of others. I mean, one of my favorites that has this quality is the Antikythera mechanism. And this is kind of beautiful. So this was in about 1901, some fishermen off the coast of Greece fished up this, what looked like this totally rusted orrery clock astrolabe-like structure. And it was dated to the second century. And it is actually that. It's a calculator for calculating the orbits of the planets. It's based on Hellenistic astronomy. But we couldn't build anything like that in the West or understand that kind of science until about the 14th century. So if we'd found it any earlier, we wouldn't know what it was anyway. It would just be a bit of metal, right? We found it in the early 20th century where we had the science by then. We'd recovered the science that had been lost. But it's a very interesting case, I mean, where unbelievably advanced ideas, unbelievably advanced systems of construction that have been lost certainly to Western civilization for almost 2,000 years. So that's a beautiful artifact and has many of these qualities, I think, of crash site. And maybe it will, I mean, you know.
But do you think that's coincidental? Like in the mysticism of object, is it possible that we found it when we were able to decipher it? Perhaps it's been like found and tossed for 2,000 years, you know? I think there is something to be said about the moment of discovery that's kind of influential.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I mean, it was dredged up. It could have been dredged up earlier and they just would have thought it was just a bit of rock or something. I think that's a very good point. It had to be restored. It wasn't pristine. And they wouldn't have known what a gear was. And so, yes, it might have just been trash. I think it's a very good point. I can't think of many other cases. Certainly, hidden languages or lost languages have mm-hmm. that character. So Linear B, for example, and so on. Where, you know, even today, there are certain languages that we can't translate. So, I don't know if there's a kind of propitious moment. I doubt it.
Okay, that's fine. You also wanted to discuss Borges in the framework of an artifact.
Yeah, so in this kind of typology of objects that we don't understand and maybe never could, there is a wonderful short story written by Jorge Luis Borges in 1945 called The Aleph. And The Aleph is a very remarkable thing. I think it looks a little bit like this is an Aleph. And it's some kind of lens. And this lens is in the basement of a very mediocre poet. And this mediocre poet has set himself the task of writing one of those kind of compendious gazetteer-like poems that covers every kind of cosmogonic poem that covers the history of every place on earth and every culture and every civilization, just ridiculous. And and it turns out that this poet who has been writing this poem about all these places possesses in his basement an Aleph. And this Aleph turns out to be a very magical object that is a single point in space that has access to all points in space. Aleph, of course, first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, symbolizes oneness. And there's a joke actually in it, because Borges later revealed that he was probably making fun of Neruda and mocking gently his extraordinary poem collection, The Heights of Machu Picchu, which have this quality of being a cosmogony. And I think Borges was a bit peeved by that. But anyway, I think the NFT is very interesting in being one of these artifacts that has magical powers, that has a kind of Faustian quality to it, that it allows you to be greater than you are. And that this poet, who was actually very mediocre, by virtue of owning this thing that no one else had, could do what they could not do. So that's a beautiful example.
Why does everything have to be embodied in an object, do you think? Why isn't there this kind of like immaterial transference? Why do things have to be discovered?
That's interesting.
I don't expect an answer. I'm just wondering.
Yeah, I don't know why our obsession with artifacts. I mean, I do think that if you think about films like Contact or novels like His Master's Voice, those are cases where it's not an artifact, it's a signal from space. I think there's something romantic about the archaeological discovery, right? In other words, to discover a signal, you have to have an antennae or a telescope. Yeah. You have to do science to begin with. And whereas if you're in your garden, you just see a giant monolith, sort of anyone can find it. I think that's what makes the crash site, alien crash site, alluring, because kids could be out playing and stumble across something extraordinary as opposed to some huge facility that's required to
do. No, I think that's good. It like every man nizes the possibility of this discovery.
Yeah, but there's also something about physical embodiment, actually. In fact, we've talked about this scientifically for quite a while, which is that what would you accept as unequivocal evidence of extraterrestrial life, right? And there's a big difference, it seems to me, between going to Mars and finding a Lovecraftian subterranean city,
right?
That would be like, okay, game over. Okay, no dispute. As opposed to beep, 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 beep. Where you think, well, you know, I don't know, that could be anything. That could be the wheel on my rover. I think there's something definitive about a physical object, which is always kind of maybe a little open when it comes to a signal.
Right, and of course the signal demands that we have an object that's capable of receiving and transferring. So we have to kind of pre-assume physical embodiment in order to capture those transmissions anyway.
That's true. But there's another maybe scientific angle on this, which goes back to early work in complexity, actually, which is, you know, what is life? Right? And how do we know? And famously in the 1940s, John von Neumann, it's one of these kind of super genius polymaths, got very interested in life as a replication. You know, what is life? Well, replication of information. And he said that wasn't sufficient, and that's a longer conversation, and I think he's right. And suggested that life should be a universal constructor. It's a bit like a factory. It's not just information is copied, it's that an object is made that can copy the information. Okay, so, and he came up with this theory of the universal constructor, which was very physical. And there was a lot of discussion up into the 60s about, you know, what would it take to build such a thing? Mm-hmm. And so it was interesting in that history that he moved towards a much more physical model of what it meant for life to exist and away from the slightly more informatic, insubstantial replication-based theory. So that's kind of interesting too.
Yeah. It demands physical replication. It demands an engineering of sorts towards the future, which is a lot more complex, I think, than maybe other early notions of what life could do, or the limits. The engineering aspect seems a little more complicated, and that would reduce quite a bit, if we take that as true, what could exist in this realm of life, which makes it harder for us.
Yeah, it's interesting, this question. I mean, we've talked about this before too, right? The Voyager 1 and 2's golden record.
Yes, and that's a good object to touch upon too.
That's an interesting object, right? Because it's kind of ridiculous. And I think now it's very interesting. So in 1977, when Carl Sagan was involved in that project, it just seemed so forward-looking that we could put on this vinyl shape. I mean, most kids now, if you showed them a record, it wasn't a golden watch, a golden MP3 file, a golden what? And so the whole idea of a golden record, actually, even without in our lifetimes, has looked like an anachronism. It's hilarious. So I think that, but then there's the question of what was on it, which is even more silly. And I think that the idea that people could translate human signals is perhaps a bit naive. That's again what I think Lem is doing in his master's voice. Mm-hmm. He's saying, you're never going to understand it. And it's not possible without having all of the physical embodiment and reference, which gives you this kind of prior information upon which you base an interpretation. Without any of that, it's meaningless. It's just ones and zeros. It could be constructed in any way you like. And you know, it's a little bit like, it's very interesting in antiquity, pre-Darwinian world, when the Greeks and the Romans dug up fossils, you know, what did they do? I mean, it's like, there are these giants. So what did they do? So in it's interesting, right? In China, they made dragons out of them, which is great. But in the Christian West, they assembled dinosaur bones into giant humans. So it's like Adam and Eve. It's like, here they are. So that's what you do, right? You interpret things according to your pre-existing beliefs and knowledge, however silly that is.
No, I think that's great. I stumbled upon a joke about the hubris of the human being in our sending of the golden record. And the joke is that our like first contact with the universe was to send unsolicited nudes, a mixtape, and directions back home. it's so good.
Yeah, that's right.
Hilarious.
Primitive society.
Right. And it's also interesting to think that even for most humans who have access to the images that are inscribed on the record or the music that's included, there were deliberate choices to create a star map that's supposedly more universally understood than the actual maps that we use when we navigate, stellar systems. So it's just funny too that there was this additional level of encryption between the ordinary human being, human language, and then what we expect an alien to be able to interpret.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was and there's that other horrible irony, and I can't remember, but in Sebald's The Rings of Saturn, he points out that the voice on the golden record, and I can't remember his name, but I think he was a former head of the UN, once was, or something, also former Nazi.
Great.
Voice of humanity in the universe, right? Yeah. So the irony.
Yes, a resounding morality expressed universally. That's great.
Yeah, by transmitting the voice of one of these most awful human beings. So there's that too.
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful. And not at all surprising.
Shoot, we didn't mention Ted Chiang. Damn.
Okay, wait. 3, 2, 1. So you wanted to discuss Ted Chiang for a little.
Now, Ted Chiang, that's a very interesting twist. Because as you said earlier, it's not an artifact. It's knowledge, and it's a knowledge of a timeless representation of events. Mm-hmm. It's actually an essay on modern approaches to classical mechanics. So that actually don't encode cause and effect relations as Newton did, but what are called action principles, which can be expressed in a timeless way. And in the film, the insight of understanding this alternative framing of mechanics, say like a Hamiltonian framing, was that we could now think back and forwards in time. Mm-hmm. And so that was very interesting, unbelievably implausible. but the idea that the gift, the artifact, appeared to be a weapon, right? But was in fact knowledge which would vastly increase our capabilities. That was a very interesting example, I think, of a non-artifactual gift.
Yes, exactly.
But it took experts, right? I mean, that it wasn't anyone who could stumble across that. The protagonist, she was right. An English.
Well, it's funny because she had the skill set. She has the specific skill set to decipher things as a linguist, but she also had the character, something that we talked about earlier. She had the character to not be confronted by fear of the unfamiliar and to also stifle the fear in others. Like China almost destroyed it. Russia almost destroyed it. So there was something also about the particular character, maybe where they were in those zones. Maybe it wasn't just headquarters across the planet, but in these areas, there is a linguist who is kind, who might be able to help us, like, you know, secure this understanding.
There was a linguist with character.
Yes, we would hope.
That is a really interesting one. Even though in his most recent stories.
Oh, I haven't read the new collection. Oh.
So he sort of, so if the story of your life was nice and optimistic, these are not so optimistic.
So do we want to get into it? Do we want to ask the dangerous question? The risk of great personal harm, death, imprisonment, what have you? What is the artifact that David Krakauer hopes to discover in the zone?
Well, I've thought about, it's very tricky. So, and I should take you through the thought process, right? Because on the one hand, I like this idea of discovering something extraordinarily modest, but which is incontrovertibly revolutionary. And there's a wonderful physicist who worked at IBM, Charlie Bennett. And Bennett makes this point that if you travel to the far ends of the universe and you arrive on a planet and you discovered a safety pin, that's all you would need, right? It's like, it's a very simple object, but what kind of civilization is required to make a safety pin, right? So it has to have metallurgy and manufacturing and nappies or whatever it has. And so, or in my case, you go that far and you discover a Rubik's Cube. Like, no way. So I think the object doesn't have to be particularly impressive, but it has to imply the existence of a certain kind of culture to be made. Actually, there's a name for this called Gutmann scaling, or implicational scaling, that there are certain objects that presuppose the existence of prior objects. For example, electricity doesn't exist in any society that doesn't also have fire, right? So they go in that order. So if you've got a Rubik's Cube,
you've got a plastic manufacturing plant.
Say, you know you've got Led Zeppelin. So I went down that path and I thought, no. So then I finally came to this idea, I have to have my own artifact, I have to invent one. And it has to have properties of the Aleph and the Antikythera mechanism and things that I really admire. So for example, this history of calculating devices I'm interested in, if some of the most beautiful artifacts on the planet now are brass and bronze calculators made in the 17th, 18th century.
Totally.
There's something called the Pascaline that Pascal, when he was 20, invented. Most people know Pascal from the Pensée and from his math and geometry. But Pascal, when he was about 18, wrote a treatise on conic sections that blew everyone away. I was like, who is this kid? And then his dad, who was a tax collector, he was making mistakes. And so he said, I'm going to invent a calculator for you, which he did. Most amazing thing. And you can see it in museums. And it looks like a little beautiful metal box. So I kind of was into those. I thought, oh, well, I like that. But then at the other end of the scale, you get things like the difference engine and the analytical engine of Babbage that was never made. It's a kind of a generalization of the Pascaline. It's a universal Turing machine, the analytical engine, but it's huge. So that doesn't work. So I don't want something huge.
Right, you have to be able to take it out of the zone.
You have to be able to kick it out, put it in your pocket.
Bring it to the Institute. You
don't have to be able to police to see that you're walking off with an analytical engine. So that's not gonna work. So what I did is I came up with my own thing and I call it the AADQ. And the AADQ is actually extremely unoriginal because it's the Aleph Antikythera quasicrystal. And
wait, I laughed and I interrupted you. Will you say it again?
I'll say it again if I can. It's the Aleph Antikythera dynamic quasicrystal. And it's the Aleph because the Aleph in the story brings all points in space to a single point. So it's this global awareness device. So I like that. On the other hand, I don't like its mystifications because I'm a scientist. And the thing about the Antikythera device is you could work out in time how it worked. So, right, and I like that. I like to think that we could eventually work it out. So that's the second part. Then I kind of like crystalline forms. I'm kind of into things that don't look living, that have living-like properties, like the Andromeda strain and so on. Because they, it's something that just looks so nondescript and so simple and yet encodes in its hidden symmetries an almost infinite amount of information, hence the quasi-crystal, the aperiodic crystal. And so this would look like, I don't know, I was thinking, I was kind of annoyed because what it might look like.
I like the idea of moving forward in this interview series and assigning all of our interviewees the homework of crafting.
Well, you know, it could look a bit like that.
Just the buzz.
You know, but that would be, I think if you found that, you'd think, that's not an AADQ. Okay. No, so that would be one possibility. But yes, so that's mine. And what it would do, I think, the sort of ethics, if you like, or the behind this position for me is that whilst it gives you this power, it can be understood and it rewards people who are rigorous in their thought, right? In other words, if you picked up the Antikythera mechanism, as you said, you'd probably, if you didn't think, you'd just throw it back in the air. He's like, what is that rubbish? And so I like this idea that it rewards the prepared mind. But then, as I said, I like the idea that it's not made out of any mechanical materials that we currently use, hence the crystalline.
Right.
And I don't know if you remember, you know, Superman, his home is the Fortress of Solitude, which is this huge crystal palace in the Arctic. And the way that he builds it is by throwing a little crystal into the snow and ice. And then this replicates into this huge palace. And I love that idea, right? I sort of love that idea of a tiny little thing that seems so lacking in internal complication. On first inspection, nevertheless expands into something bewildering. So that's my
like artifact. A viral particle. It's a little scary.
Like a viral particle, but a nice one, a kind viral.
A beneficent one. Okay, so when you say that you hope that it rewards rigor, it seems to me that like a Rubik's Cube or like these puzzly things you've shown us, even if it's made from this unrecognizable crystal structure, there's got to be something kind of pliable about it. I'm really trying to imagine what it might look like.
Yeah, no, I don't know either. I mean, that's part of the problem because I haven't yet found it. And when I will, I will show it to you.
Thank you.
What else do I have here that, you know, I mean, oh, yeah, I mean, interestingly, in my office, you know, that's kind of Rosetta Stone, like this sort of, kind of interesting, isn't it? This could kind of look a bit like that, but crystalline perhaps. The other side to this though, and I think it is more of an SFI side, is the idea that an entire community would devote their lives to comprehending it. That's a little bit like the glass bead game, right? So this idea that this tiny little thing, but like the Aleph has infinite universal complexity, communities would dedicate their lives to mastering it or trying to. So that glass bead game like element interests me too. It's not just an artifact that gives one person some special power, but actually accretes around it an entire culture of investigation.
Well, but so that kind of brings us back to the trade-offs in Roadside Picnic. Who's to say that a stalker doesn't come across your AADK or DQ and sell it to a bartender for $300 because they need to feed their kid, and therefore it exists outside of the realm of the institute that's dedicating itself to the study of it. And then at the same time, you could put your spec suit on and get in your flying car and, like, through the rigors of protocol, approach the zone. Maybe you'll never discover it, but if you have, then you have the community of minds around it. So there's also this kind of, the community, I think, exists. I think that's relevant. And I think that SFI is a perfect example of that. But you still need the kind of fearless criminal to, like, come get it. I don't know if that's you. It might be. You just also happen to be the president of the Institute.
I stole it. No, I think that's a good point. I hadn't thought. There's two sides to what you just said, right? One is the character required to make the discoveries could be quite different from those who understand it.
Right.
And that's absolutely true. I mean, even true now, right? I mean, with space exploration and, you know, test pilots and astronauts and geeks on the ground, you know. And geeks in space too. But I think
almost primarily.
But yeah, right, that's true. So there's that side, but then there's who possesses it. That's, and it certainly is true, right, that if you look at beautiful medieval, Renaissance, early history of science, like artifacts, many of them in private collections, because they have the money to own them,
right,
not necessarily the wherewithal to understand them. And I think that's a very good point. Perhaps that is the history of artifacts, like moving between these communities, those who can afford them and those who can study them and so on. It's a good point.
And those who never ever access them.
But it's sort of true, I'm sort of thinking now that you say that, that's sort of true of, if you think of complex reality as a kind of large version of this artifact, then it's sort of true. I mean, funding agencies, right? And then those who receive the grants to study them, and they're not the same necessarily, the same people.
Right. You would hope that it's a world full of Medicis. They want the beautiful things, but they want the people who are going to understand, assess the beautiful things. And those are the ones who are employed. But it's not often that, you know? It's quite often kept within my palace, just for me and my amusement.
Yeah.
It's the question that kind of crosses across various types of these discoveries throughout humanity.
But to your point, I mean, the reverse is true, right? I mean, I mentioned the glass bead game, but remember, but in that novel, the magister ludi, the kind of the great adept of the game, which is kind of like a super game of life, it's like a mandala that you manipulate, like a go board or something. The protagonist decides at a certain point that that's not enough, that you can't isolate yourself from society. You have to give back, and that's what he does. He leaves, you know, Castalia in order to go back into society and inform people of what he's learned.
Unfortunately,
drowned before he can do that. But nevertheless, that's also interesting with making your insights accessible.
And so what would the AADQ solve for humanity when collected, removed, and understood? Is there a problem that it addresses, or is it just like a wonderful new solution to problems we haven't even thought existed yet?
Oh, that's a good one. I hadn't got to that point.
That's good. Well, it's funny because
I like that.
Well, I ask because I think when I think about asking other people, when I think about this question myself, I almost kind of work backwards, and it's like, okay, I want this to be resolved. I think this would do it. And so I want to find a device that does X to Y to make solution Z. But that's not, it's interesting to me that you went object first. It's so opposed to my thought process.
Oh yeah, I think because yours is much more noble. No, in a way, no, it's interesting. I think it's the difference between, it's a very good point. It's wanting to solve a problem versus wanting to solve a puzzle. And I have to say, to my shame, I'm sort of interested in solving the puzzle. And you're absolutely right. I think that is the glass beacon thing, the dilemma, right?
Right.
He was just working on this very esoteric problem, but to whose benefit? And I think you make it, it's a very interesting question about pure and applied science even. I like the question because if you think the majority, it's interesting, like, I guess the cases that we've discussed are mixed, mm-hmm. right? So in other words, like, certainly the Rosetta Stone was functional, the Pascaline was functional, the monoliths were kind of functional, you know, in a certain way. The Andromeda strain, I can't give away, it is functional, but not for us.
It functions well.
Well, given their nefarious objective.
Right, precisely.
Whoever they are. So they often do have this character that they were built with utility in mind. But I think it's true to say that a lot of scientists are much more engaged with the puzzle than the use. I would be quite happy to give the AADQ after I'd gained mastery of the universe to anyone else.
Right. Once you've made all the sides the same color, then you can bestow it upon humanity. Yeah, you can
enjoy.
That's great.
I think there are three sides to why I'm interested in these artifacts.
Three.
You know, it has to be three. If it's not three,
I'm for it. I'm fine.
And I think it's one is just because I just like artworks, right? In other words, artifacts, and their intrinsic aesthetic qualities and all that. So think of it just as decorative art, sculpture, right? Doesn't have to have any value, utility. The other deeper issues have to do with the nature of intelligence. Both ours and theirs, right? It touches my work because I'm interested in intelligence, I think, and the origin of it in the universe. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a meteorite hitting the Earth is a wonderful and interesting event, as long as it doesn't hit somebody. But it's completely consistent with physical law as we understand it. But a giant iron Rubik's Cube landing in the desert in New Mexico, now that's something else entirely, right? And it still obeys gravity. I mean, it's still a cosmological event, but it's more than that, right? Because encoded within it are clues about the sort of time-wasting tendencies of life anywhere in the universe. That's the sort of thing I want to know.
That's good.
All right, that was good.
So that was it. So thank you guys for tuning in. This was Alien Crash Site. This was episode 0 featuring David Krakauer. I'm Caitlin McShea. Tune in next time for an interview with Ashton Eaton, gold medal Olympic decathlon winner twice, world record breaker, mechanical engineer to be, future astronaut and friend.
You know, we know, right, that Ashton goes everywhere carrying a piece of pine tree.
Yeah.
You know, so if you had to ask me now what I think he's going to say, it's either going to be a pine cone or something like that.
Right.
Pine leaf, which he can crush and smell so as not to feel nervous in competition. Right. Or it could be an Omega Speedmaster watch because he wants to be an astronaut. Mm-hmm. The artifact of record for the astronaut.
Yeah, the legend, the legacy.
Easy, right.
See you next time.
Nanu, nanu.
Okay. Boop. All right, that was good.